Good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are in the world. Today we have the first webinar in a three-part series from Diego Rodriguez Losada of Conan, covering how to manage C and C++ packages. Please note the Q&A option at the bottom of your console and use that for any questions, and we will answer them at the end of the webinar. Thank you to everyone for joining, and go ahead, Diego, take it away.
Thanks very much, and thanks very much, everybody, for attending this webinar. As hopefully we are going to spend some time together for in these three webinars, please let me first introduce myself. So I was a professor at university and I was a full-time researcher. My topics were robotics and artificial intelligence. But basically what I was doing the whole day was coding in C and C++. I was doing algorithms, I was doing user interfaces, and many things related to robotics and artificial intelligence. Also, I had the chance to be involved in many different projects, industrial projects for companies, where I really like software engineering. So I really appreciate design and protocols and things like that, also working in different languages too. But in 5 years ago, I quit academia. So I quit my full tenure track position. And I founded a startup that tried to make a dependency manager for all languages. That startup finally didn't work, but we learned many lessons. And we didn't give up. So we, together with Luis, we co-created the Conan package manager, and we have been working in it for a while now. And now we are running a senior software engineer in JFrog. And I'm working with Conan full time. So how did everything of this start? Basically, it was scratching my own itch because I was the whole day coding in C and C++. And at some moments, I want to just to reuse some software that was out there. For example, this is OpenCV. It's a very famous, very popular library for computer vision. And when you want to use it, and for example, you are in Windows, then you realize that inside the repository, this is the GitHub repository, there is a third-party folder. And inside that folder, you can find the source code of all the dependencies. And so you can see here, you see libjpg, several libraries for image processing. And the thing is that OpenCV in Windows, it's using, it's building from sources, these sources that are just copied and pasted inside the repository. So it's only Windows. In Linux, they will use the package manager or they will another approach. But it was kind of weird, of course. On the other hand, there are also different people that are releasing libraries with a different approach. For example, this one, this also for image processing library. And it is just one file, one single header file. I think it's about 40,000 lines of code in a single header file. So of course, this is very convenient for users because it's very easy to integrate in your project, but it's poor software engineering. And it can block your compile times and have many other issues. Also, other very popular libraries like Boos or Poco libraries, they are not just a library. They are actually a huge number of libraries. Boos can have like very a few tens of libraries. And it happens that when you want to just use a small functionality of those libraries, then you have to install all of it because it's not easy to just get the part that you need. So I have to say, all these projects, I'm not saying it's their fault, they are all amazing projects. I love all of them. They are great software. They are brilliant code. I hope someday I could write such amazing C++ code. But the thing is that when they were developed, they didn't have a package manager, so they had to deal with the thing of dependencies as they could, and they were developing just many libraries. So there is no point for someone within a library just to create a full package manager for their library to work. So they had to deal with these things, and especially in C and C++, the problem is a bit bigger. because there are different compilers in different in different operating systems. There are different build systems. In fact, there are even like meta build systems like CMake. So the thing is complicated. So they did just what they what it was convenient for them as developers. So what are some existing approaches to dependency management for C and C++? One thing could be use the system package managers. So the most popular ones could be, of course, those of Linux distributions. There are several of them. There are the Debian packages based one, like Debian and Ubuntu. While the Red Hat family, they will use RPM packages. And other Linux distributions, they use other approaches. I think they are robust, they are fast, they are very convenient, they help you install thousands of applications and also a lot of libraries, open source libraries you can use as developer. So these are very good systems. I'm not saying that they are not. But what happens when you go to Windows? In Windows, the space is a bit different. So there is a package manager, it's called Nougat. It has a huge success for C Sharp. For C Sharp is the reference package manager and everybody is using it and loving it and it's working pretty well. They try to use it for C C++ packages, but actually it didn't get a lot of traction because C and C++ packages are a different beast. So actually it's not very used by developers to publish and to use C++ packages. And also there is another application, it's called Chocolaty for Windows. And it's very useful for installing applications. So there are some applications there you might install with Chocolaty and it's very convenient. But at the end it's not something useful for developers. So some developers that they were concerned that they wanted the libraries to be used in Windows, they even took the time to build installers. So either, for example, using the Microsoft installer is kind of convenient because it is integrated in Visual Studio. So with Visual Studio, you can generate MSI packages or other tools that I like it. I've used it a lot and I like it. It's also InnoSetup. It basically the same. It creates an executable that you can run and it will install a package, let it be an application or a library for developers somewhere in the system. And also in Mac, in Apple OS X, the most successful approach will be the brew one, the homebrew one. It's a very interesting project and widely used by developers in OS X. It is based on the idea of having Ruby formula. There are like Ruby scripts that define the package. They will be processed in a place, in a folder called the seller, so they will not affect the system until the last step that is the system will just symlink those seller applications libraries to be used by developers. And there is a central repository that is managed and moderated by the Ruby community, but you can also set up your own tab and you can upload your Ruby formula there. And another good thing that I like from Brew is that it can manage binary bottles. These binary bottles are actually for the public Brew. They are hosted in Bintray. So this project is kind of inspiration too. But the thing is that, okay, so this system, they can work fine for their operating systems. But the problem is that you have like many of them. And if you're just building a library and you want just to publish it so other developers around the world can use your library, then it would be a huge amount of work to maintain all those packages in all those systems, okay? So the system package managers are very convenient from a sysadmin point of view, but they are not very developer friendly. So for system packages, they are fine. But one thing that they will typically be not very intuitive from my point of view is managing multiple versions for the same package. For example, if you are using CMake, you can find that mainstream distributions will have like a very old version of CMake, and other will have just the latest one, and probably updating it can be difficult, or it can be difficult to run different versions at the same time. If you want to maintain compatibility with different versions, probably it can be a difficult thing. And also, there is no standard way of consuming the information of those packages from the developer point of view. So Linux will have the PC files that they will help, but other system they won't. So it's also a problem. And another one is that the main central repositories, they are moderated. So you cannot just upload there just as you do in GitHub. Just create your package and upload there, because it will be probably rejected, it is not matching the quality or whatever. So it's not that easy to manage with a central repository. Also, besides system package managers, it deserves some mention, the use of Git. There are two functionalities there, is Git submodules and Git subtree. Both of them can be and have been used by C and C++ developers to kind of manage dependencies. From my point of view, friends don't let friends to use Git features for real dependency management, because at the end it's complex, it is error prone, it is not really a solution, but it's something that people have been doing for a while. So then, what have all other languages have been doing? They have not been using the system package managers. So every modern language, they have their own system. They have their own tools to manage dependencies and to manage packages. For example, Java will have Maven and so on. So something that for me, that I was working in C++ for a long time, when I started to work in Python, for me it was amazing, because it didn't matter the system I was working on, like Linux or Windows or whatever. If I wanted an HTTP client, I would just run pip install request, and I would have a very feature complete, a robust HTTP client to do HTTP requests. And it just worked, and it was very easy. Just 1 minute to install is really, really simple. And something that especially annoys me, because I was doing like a low level, and one thing that I will usually do was communicating over a serial port. In C++, there is no standard for a serial port. In Python, you just write pip install by serial, and then you have a serial port. Very easy to send bytes over a serial port. And the funny thing, actually, is that the implementation of this Python package, the internals, it is a C code. It is not Python code. This is C code, but it is packaged with a Python wrapper. So I love the way that and the simplicity of the Python packages. Also, I've worked a bit with Java. I have to say that it's not my favorite language, but the ecosystem of Java is brilliant, from the Java virtual machine to the tools. So for example, you have those tools, the Maven or Gradle. So you are working with Java, you want a dependency, you want to try a new or integrate a new library, and then you just write it. You write it in your dependencies section, you will run Maven install, and you will get it installed in your machine and using your application. So this is absolutely amazing for developers. But in C and C++, we didn't have this. So in my experience that I've able to talk with many companies, I've seen different approaches. One of them would be, for example, the one of just using readmes. So a repository will just contain like a big readme with all the setup instruction. Okay, so you have to download this library, put this in this exact location in your machine, then install this other library, do this, do that, and then you can spend like half a day or even a day for setting up a big project in a new machine, all readme driven. But it's something that's done. But when the things grow, and then people and developers, they need to develop something. So finally, what they do is they develop their own custom tools, from package managers or dependency managers to build systems. Something turn. Okay. So I've seen many, many custom solutions in companies to manage packages. This is not working. Okay. So from my experience, what would be the ideal criteria for a CNC++ package manager? Of course, it has to be open source. All the other package managers, they are all open source. So this is not even a criteria. This is something that that has to be. But there are other things that we can, and we actually might want from a CNC++ package manager. One very important thing for me is that CNC++ projects can be huge, and actually they are huge. So once I run a survey, it's not very statistically significant, but I was reading that a JavaScript project was like having like 18,000 of lines of code, and it was huge. So I was asking people, and people told me that actually a huge C++ project would be more than 1 million lines of code. And many of them actually say, no, it will be from 10 million lines of code. The problem with this size of projects is that the compilation times can be huge too. So for example, to build a full project, it could be like one day, like servers building all the stuff. So of course, if we want to have a package manager for C++, binary management is a must. Of course, if your project has only like two or three dependencies, then probably you don't need a CNC++ package manager. If your project is big and you have 10 million lines of code, probably structured in 50 libraries or 100 libraries, then you have to cache all the binaries, all the libraries, and store them somewhere. So yeah, managing binaries is a must. Then what happens with build systems? We have seen that CNC++, they have different compilers and different build systems in every single platform. So these are some statistics from JetBrains. They are developing like the CLion IDE, which in my opinion is a great IDE. I highly recommend it. So in their studies, they can see that there are many different build systems. And the most used one would be CMake. It is not even half of the market. So it's only 38% of the market would use CMake. So package manager is absolutely necessary that they can handle any build system. So they cannot be tied to a specific build system, because you cannot just discard more than half of the market for CNC++ just because your tool is not managing it. So a proper package manager should handle any build system. Also, then it comes the language. So what would be the best language to implement a CNC++ package manager? This is a matter of discussion, but okay. So we need two things here. First, we need to describe the packages, and then we need to implement the package manager backend. So for the package description, there are two approaches. There will be the description one, like using XML files, JSON files, YAML files, whatever, or using a scripting language. So we soon realized that you really need a full scripting language, because for CNC++, the variety is so huge that every project requires different things. And the only way to provide something powerful is to allow developers and package creators to write their logic. So if they want to use ifs, if they want to use for loops, if they want to structure their packages like with proper software engineering, they need a full scripting language. So, and then the implementation. We know that the homebrew is a success story, of course, they are using Ruby, but we also realized that practically all of the companies that they were developing tools for CNC++, they were writing them in Python. Not in CNC++, because for these kind of jobs, Python is a very good tool. It is quick to prototype, quick to work with it. So it made perfect sense. So in my opinion, the perfect language for describing packages will be Python, because it's not my decision. It's just the trend of the market. It's what people are doing. And then as you are writing the package description in Python, then the natural approach to write the backend of the package manager is also in Python. It is extremely convenient. And finally, one thing that a package manager should implement for C and C++ is to be decentralized. This seems pretty obvious, but it is not. So it should be the same as Git. So you can run very easily your own on-premises private server. And this should be easy. And you should be able to get artifacts and packages from different servers if you want. And you must be able to host your precompiled binaries in those servers. Of course, similarly or very related to it is that package manager should work very well offline. So if you don't have connection to the servers, you still, and your package, of course, if your packages are installed in your machine, everything should be able to work locally. So for us, these are the basic criteria that a package manager for C and C++ should meet. Let's see other existing solutions. So for example, one thing, okay, building a package manager, as there are many build systems, is a complex thing. So some existing approaches would just, okay, let's write a new build system and let's use this unique build system for every operating system, for every platform, and this is going to be a modern build system, everything cool. So this is good from a theoretical point of view, but the reality is that people are not going to just drop their build systems and adopt a new one. So the actual penetration of the market of those solutions is very small. Of course, the thing is that the idea behind it is that if you own the build system and you design the build system, it is much more easier to build a package manager integrated with that build system, all in a joint solution. Something like Cargo will be for Rust. Then a very common approach would be that one of using CMake utilities, because CMake, besides a meta build system, is a scripting language, probably not the most beautiful one on earth, but it is a scripting language that can be used for different things. So for example, you can download a file from the internet, you can add external projects that are not in your project, but are in your machine, and you can define the process to download the project, build the project, and things like that with CMake. So in my opinion, the problem with CMake is that it is not a proper scripting language. So actually the process of evaluating CMake scripts, it is a two-step process. Then you first configure the project and then you execute the build of the project. So it's very difficult with CMake scripting to build the complexity that a real package manager needs. So this is something that can be done, but are not a really full solution. So there are some approaches like Hunter or Microsoft VC package there, that they are using CMake scripts as recipes or as ports to describe packages. Basically, both of them, they are always building from sources, so they are not managing binaries. There's no client-server architecture. They are just using a repository of scripts. And let's say that they are more like Homebrew or System Package Manager, but with the issue that they are building from sources. Okay, so let's talk about a bit about Conan and how it does implement those criteria that we have seen. As a summary, let's say that Conan would be like, of course, it's an open source project. It would be like Maven, but for C and C++ projects. It is portable. It will work in Windows, Linux, Mac. Actually, it works also in, there are people using it in Solaris, SunOS, and FreeBSD. I have run it myself in Raspbian, for example, in different flavors of Linux. So it works in many different platforms. It is MIT licensed. And I will show you in a real life demonstration how it implements the things that I've been talking about. So this is an overview of what I'm going to demonstrate. Okay, so the demonstration will have two parts. The first one, I have the Conan client tool installed in my machine. So I'm going to build a project that is using existing packages. Okay, the existing packages will be those for the POCO libraries. Okay, they are hosted in Conan.io. Here you can see the decentralized architecture of Conan. So I will retrieve my artifacts, my packages from Conan.io to build a project based on the POCO libraries. Okay, that will be the first part, just as a pure consumer of packages. And then I will show you how to create a package from existing code and then upload to Artifactory and then reuse it as it was another developer, another team, or you in a different machine are reusing the binary that you previously created for that package. So this will be my presentation. I'm going to use JFrog Artifactory as my server to upload this package. I could also use the Conan server open source servers, but JFrog is going to be nicer because I can also show the user interface, how to set it up and navigate the packages. It will be nice. Okay, so let's move to the actual demonstration. Yeah, so here, I hope you can see it clearly. Here's my command line. I'm going to execute everything on the command line. And I'm going to start with a POCO example. So here I have a very simple project, just three files. The first file would be the MD5 CPP file. I'm going to show you the contents of this file. Okay, so it's a very simple application that is using the POCO library. And it's using the POCO library to compute the MD5 checksum of a string, a hello world string. So simple thing. Today could be quite trendy that they have broken the SHA-1 SHA. Let's do some hashing here. Okay, so I want to build this application. So the first thing I need is I need the POCO libraries. Okay, so I'm going to close the source code. And okay, I need POCO. What I'm going to do as a consumer, I'm going to write a Conan file.txt file. Okay, this file is going to be simple. There are two sections. In the first one, the requires one, I will declare my dependencies. I will say, okay, so I want to build my application. I want to use POCO, the version 1.7.2. And the second section of this file here is the generators one. Here, I am saying that I'm going to use CMake as my build system. For example, I could use here a different generator. I could use like QMake or even Visual Studio or another one if I was using a different build system, but I'm using CMake. So I will use CMake here. And then my process, I will show you the CMake list file after. First, I'm going to install my dependencies. This is all I need to install my dependencies. So I'm going to do it in a temporary folder. So I'm just creating a build folder. I'm moving to it, okay? And I'm going to do a Conan install. Just point it to the Conan file I just showed you. Okay, so now it is downloading things. POCO is might take a couple of seconds to unzip the package. Okay, so now it has installed different packages on my machine. Actually, you can see that it has installed more than one package. If you see my screen, then you will see that it has installed not only POCO, but also OpenSSL and Zlib. Why? Because they are transitive dependencies of POCO. POCO is depending on OpenSSL to actually compute the checksums. And OpenSSL in turn is depending on Zlib. Okay? So I can see my dependency graph with the info command. I can see that POCO is requiring OpenSSL here. OpenSSL is required by POCO. It is requiring Zlib. Zlib is required. So here I can see a lot of meta information of the packages. Also, I can inspect my local cache, and I can see that I have these three recipes installed in my local cache. Okay, they are cached as you can see. So if I issue a Conan install again, it's going to be almost immediate because they are already in my machine. And another thing that I can do, I can check a specific recipe, a specific package recipe. For example, this one from zlib. So I can search it, and it's going to show me the information of the binaries. A given package recipe, it can have many different binaries for different settings and different configuration. In this case, it is showing that it just installed for me one binary that is for Visual Studio 14, because those are my defaults. If I want, I can change it. If I'm going to use a different Visual Studio, different version, the debug version, I can also install it. This will be done in the second webinar. So for now, just let me show that I can. I have my package recipe, I have my package binary for POCO, and also all the transitive dependencies, OpenSSL and zlib, they are all installed there. So Conan has generated a couple of files here for me, and the interesting one right now is the Conan build info CMake. It is a big file, but it's very simple in essence. So this file here is basically a set of variables, a set of CMake variables, that they are declaring different things I need for my build. For example, it is declaring like the include paths of the libraries, it is declaring the library names, it is declaring some preprocessor defines I have to use if I want to properly link with those libraries. So it contains all the information necessary for the consumer to link with the packages without having to spend a lot of time. So now it is time that I'm going to show you my actual build script. It's the CMake list. So the first two lines of my build script for my project is a standard CMake, defining the project. And then I just need to include the file that Conan has generated for me, because it contains all those definitions. Then I'm calling just a convenient macro that will do the typical setup for me. If I don't want to do it, it is fine. I can just use the variables as a standard CMake variables and use them for my build as I want. Then the last two lines, the executable and the target link libraries, it is very standard CMake syntax, just to create a binary application and to say that this application need to link with the libraries that has been retrieved. Okay, so everything is there, so I can just build my project. As you can see, I am in Windows, I'm using Visual Studio. First, I'm going to configure my project. And then I'm going to actually build my project. I could, of course, instead of doing this step in the command line, okay, I could just open the Visual Studio IDE, because CMake generated the Visual Studio IDE, and I could build from the IDE, because for this demonstration, it's better just to stay in the command line. So I just built my application, and here it is. So the amazing thing here, for me, is something incredible in Windows. With just one command, I was able to install all POCO libraries very quickly and automatically, but also OpenSSL library and set libraries. OpenSSL is not that easy to build or install in Windows. And in this way, it is absolutely transparent for me. I'm using OpenSSL hashing algorithms for free and very easily. So for me, that I developed a lot in Windows, this is absolutely amazing. Okay, so this would be basically the way you are consuming packages. The packages that are already existing elsewhere, but the question here is, okay, this looks good. I want to use it for my own packages. Okay. So now I'm going to show you how to do this. I'm going to start with a repository here in GitHub. Okay, this repository contains the implementation of a Hello World library. It's very simple, just a standard C++. Here you will see like the hello function. It will bring to STDC out Hello World. Okay, and this CMake file contains just standard CMake stuff. So this repository doesn't have a single line of code related to Conan. It's just a CMake project with C++ code that is building a library, it's building an application, okay? So what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a package for this project here, okay? And then I'm going to create the package, create the binaries, reuse the binaries and everything. So let's start with it. Okay, so the only file that I need to create a package would be the Conan file. In this case, it's going to be a Python file. I'm going to open it, but don't worry too much about the things it contains right now, because it can be generated from a template. I could just write Conan new package version whatever. Include test and it will generate from a template. It will generate the basics for me. It's very, very convenient. But in any case, you can just open your editor and write your file. So this would be the basic recipe for creating a package. It is, as you can see, it is a Python script and with a class. There are five important things here. The first part would be the metadata. This part here, I can declare the name of the package, the version of the package, okay, and then the settings. There are other metadata like the URL for the repository, the author, the license. There are many different things you can declare here in the metadata of the package, but for the simplest case, I can just do this. The settings one is a very important one. It defines, we will get deep into these certain things in the next webinar, but basically you get the idea that it defines things that affect my binaries. So for example, if I change operating system, I will have a different binary from the same source code. If I change my compiler, I will get a different binary from the same source code. And if I change my build time from debug to release, of course I get a different binary. And if I change my architecture from 32 bits to 64 bits, my binaries will also be different. Okay, so this is basically what I'm declaring here in this settings field. Then I have four methods, okay? Even if it is the first time you read a Conan file recipe, you probably can understand them. The first one would be the source one. The source one is just defining the source code origin. In this case, I'm running a Git clone from the GitHub repository I just showed you, but you can just download from SourceForge, you can download from elsewhere, you can run anything you want here to retrieve your own code. You can run, for example, code generators, you can run them in this function, so you can do a lot of things here. There are other approaches to use the source function. But for this case, it is pretty simple, and I think you get the idea. Then we have the build method, okay? The build method just wraps your build system. You can use any build system as long as you specify how you convert from your source code to your binaries inside the build function, it will work. So you can see here the self-run CMake. It is just calling CMake, as I did in my command line. It is true that for CMake build system, for example, we have a helper. We have a helper that allows us to easily convert the settings, the Conan settings, to CMake syntax. But it is just a helper. You can just code it yourself or adapt your build system or whatever and just call it. So it is quite a simple concept. Okay. Then once the binaries are built, we have to define a package method here. The package method will just extract the artifacts I'm interested in and put them in the final package. So for example, it, a typical thing would be to package the headers. So just copy the headers to an include destination directory in the package. Then copy the libraries also to a lib folder inside the package. So when the package is executed, you will end with a folder that contains an include subfolder with headers, a lib folder with the libraries. It's pretty simple. And then finally, we have the package info method. The package info method is the information for my consumers. So it could be the same concept as the PC files in Linux. So here you can declare anything you need for your consumers. In this case, I'm telling my consumers that if you want to link with this package, you have to link with a library called hello. Okay? So this is interesting because even for packages that they change their configuration widely, for example, there are packages that will use a different name for the library if they are in debug mode. So you can just do it, put it here. Okay, if settings equal debug, then your library will be called hello-d, and else your library will be called hello. And you can write any logic here you need for your consumers to easily link with your package and with your libraries inside your package. Okay, so here, this could be the basic recipe. This recipe is in my user space. So if I want to add it to Conan and convert it in a real Conan recipe, I have to export it into my local cache. So now, just the export command just took my recipe from my user space and put it in the local cache. So if I do a Conan search, now I will find that I have four recipes, four packages. I will have the OpenSSL and POC and setlib, and I also have a hello recipe there. Okay? So now the recipe is there. It is prepared to be consumed as a from other projects. How do I know if this recipe is working? It is working, it is good, it is bad. So the natural thing would be, okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm moving to a consumer project, okay? And the consumer project will be just the same as I did with the POCO example. It will be a simple source file, and it will contain a Conan file that requires the package that I have just put into the local cache. So if I repeat the process that I did for the POC example, I'm going to install my package, and then I will get an error message. This error message, I will summarize it for you. It basically means that there is no binary. If I search for the binaries, hey, there are no packages, there are no binaries for this recipe. So what I have to do is I need to build it from sources. So when I install, by default, install won't build from sources. It will try to use existing binaries. If I want to build from sources, I have to specify it. Okay, so here we are. It is cloning from GitHub. Now it is compiling the package. Okay, everything good. So now I can see that I have a package here. Okay, so I can repeat my the steps to build my application, building my consuming application, okay, so it seems that my package is working. I created the package, I created the pre-compiled binary, and it is working. Okay, so now I want to share it with my team. This package is fine, so I want to upload to some remote. So what I'm going to do here is I'm going to create in Artifactory, I'm going to create a repository for Conan. I'm going to create a Conan repository. Let's call it Conan local. Now, here, Conan local will have some set me up instructions. They are very easily in short. What I need to do is in my Conan client, it is exactly the same as Git, the same model. So Conan remote add my remote and the URL of the repository that Artifactory created for me. Okay, so now I have set up my remote and I can just Conan upload my package. I'm going to specify that I want to upload it to my remote, and --all means, okay, I want to upload everything. I want to upload the package recipe. I want to upload all the binaries that I have in my local cache. Okay, everything seems good. Let's check it in Artifactory. And I can see that my package is already there. Okay, and actually there is a package here and I can check its properties, the settings for Windows. This is a package binary for Windows, 64 bits, release, Visual Studio, and whatever. I could repeat the process and upload many packages here. So to finish my demonstration, what I'm going to do is, okay, let's check if this works. Let's just wipe all my local cache. This will completely remove all the packages from my local cache. Of course, if I try to build my application right now, it will fail because the libraries are no longer there. So what I can do now, let's figure that I'm a different developer in a different machine. All I need to do is Conan install, let's install my dependencies. It will retrieve the package recipe from Artifactory. It will retrieve the binary, the precompiled binary from Artifactory, and it will just be available there so I can leak my application. Okay, so this would be the end of my presentation. Just to finish, before the taking questions, I would like to invite you to join us to SwampUp in May. This will be an amazing conference and we will be there talking about DevOps for C and C++. So this is a place to be. So really recommend to join us there. And also, this will be the next webinar. We will be talking about generating binaries for different configurations, API compatibility, using different sources origins and advanced topics of C and C++ package management. So thanks very much for your attention. And now I think it's time for taking questions.
Yep, hi Diego. So we have a few questions that people sent in here. The first one for you is it recommended to avoid exporting source with package recipes when they maintain both the source and the package?
Actually, I like the approach of the approach that I've just used, that is getting the sources from elsewhere. So in this case, you can maintain the source code in your GitHub repository and clone from it, because in that way you get an extra layer, for example, of security of accessing the source code. Okay, but the truth is that you can Conan can support both workflows. If you want to snapshot the source code of a package, then you can just copy the source of the package into the package recipe. So when you need to build a recipe, you need to build a new binary from sources, it doesn't need to retrieve the source code from elsewhere. So the answer could be, it depends. if you like to have the Conan file recipe inside your package, inside your package source repo, then I would recommend snapshotting. But if you want to maintain like the source repositories and the package recipes in different places, it would be better to use the source method and cloning the sources from elsewhere. So it is not either recommended or not recommended. It depends on the approach you want to use.
Okay, thank you, Diego. The next question is, what is the relationship, if any, between the ConanFile.py used to consume Conan packages and the ConanFile.py to publish a Conan package? For some libraries, you may even want to do both simultaneously.
Yeah, that's a good question. Actually, the ConanFile text file is just a simplification of the ConanFile Python. So the truth is that you can use the same ConanFile both for consuming and also for packaging. So the build method and the source method and things like that, they can execute even in your local space. If you just git clone a project, you just can write a Conan install, and you can use the same Conan file .py that you are using to create the package. You can use it to install the dependencies while you are developing that package. When that package is not in the package manager, but it is open for edition. So the Conan file will be exactly the same. Will be exactly the same for consuming and for creating the package. And the methods can be individually called. There are commands it's a Conan source command that will just call the source method for package creators to debug and to prove that things are working. You will have a Conan build command that will call just the build method. You will get a Conan package command that will call the package method. Okay, so all of them, they can be run locally while you are developing the package inside your user space, and they will run also when you export the package and the package is being built by the system. So yes, it will be the same file, and you will use the same file for both things.
Okay, perfect. Thank you. We have a couple more. So as a follow-up to the first question, what are best practices when fetching source with Git? Do you tag branches or store a hash commit in the recipe to check out after cloning? And is there a way around having to actually push source code while trying to test packages locally during development?
Yeah, so for me, the best practice would be to use tags or branches. So when you do in the source method, you do a git clone, then you will check out the branch or the tag you want. Typically, it will match the version you are declaring in your package recipe. So this will be the branch that you are checking out for building from sources. So the thing is that you are writing a package recipe, and then you will need some work to do. So for example, packages have scopes. So you can use scopes. Scopes are a kind of variable that you can set up for your recipe. That it will make it behave differently. So you can have a package with a scope called open or under edition, for example, and you can say, okay, if the package is under edition, then get the source code from this folder in my local machine, and you don't need to go and git clone. So the good thing here is that all the methods that define a recipe, you can implement conditional logic in all of them. So if the source method, you want to implement conditional logic based on some setting in some, for example, you can just retrieve different some source code in different systems. You can get the zip file in Windows, and you can get the .gc file in Linux from SourceForge, for example, if you are in different systems. So you can build your conditional logic inside the source method very, very easily. So in this case, I guess that using scopes will allow to just use the source code in a local repo and just copy to the recipe.
Perfect. Thank you, Diego.
You're welcome.
Okay, so here's another one for you. If you have multiple levels of Conan dependencies, is there one Conan build info.cmake file for each, or one global one?
Okay. Yeah. So when you use the CMake generator, then you will get just one Conan build info CMake file with all the information. But the thing is that you will have a lot of variables there. So you will get variables per package. So you will get the include paths for POCO, the include paths for OpenSSL, and then you will get also variables that are accumulated. For example, it will get all the libraries' names to link with in the proper order you need. So if you want to take them from the single package variables, you can. If you want to use the accumulated variables, you can. And also for modern CMake, the Conan.info CMake file is also defining targets. So you, instead of using the variables, you can use directly use the targets that that are defined. So in this way, it will automatically use the dependency propagation of CMake targets to put all the libraries and everything in order. So yeah, just one Conan.info CMake with all the information for all the dependencies, but available at different levels per package and all the package aggregators as a variables or as independent targets.
All right, and actually we got one question via email since we have a couple minutes left. The question is, how does Conan manage cross-compiling for different architectures?
Okay, so actually I think I will be able to do it for the next webinar, for the next one. Cross-compiling is not difficult. I mean, you just need to set up your compiler, and we manage environment variables. For example, if you can set the CC compiler or CXX compiler in environment variables, and then you will just when you build the package with those settings, and okay, I'm in Windows, but I want to package this package for Linux. And then it will use that compiler to cross build to Linux. So I think we will be able to. It's very easy, just to define the environment variables pointing to your cross compiler, and then the process will just get a new binary for it with the different settings, and they will manage all together in Artifactory on the Conan server separately. So with the Conan model of settings and everything, is just a matter of defining your cross-compiler. Of course, it depends. If you need a complex tool chain, for example, if you want to develop for Android, it can be done. There are users that are cross-compiling to Android, but it might require a bit more of work into your recipe to define your location of your tool chain, what are the options, the different, because a tool chain can have different versions too for Androids and things like that. So it might require a bit more of specification of the tool chain that you are using. As we saw, there is just a build method, and you can put it anything you want there. So we will provide all the facilities and all the utilities to do cross-compiling. But at the end, if the tool chain is not defined, you can just define your own tool chain, and it will manage it for you. Hopefully, I will be able to show this in one of the next webinars.
Perfect. Thank you, Diego.
You're welcome.
Okay, so thank you to everyone for joining today. We'll wrap it up now. We will be sending out the slides as well as the answers from this Q&A and a link to the next webinar and our follow-up, so please look out for that. And thank you to everyone who joined.
Thanks very much for everyone attending.
Have a great day.
Bye-bye.